Good afternoon, dear students. So, in the last class, I have discussed about spinal cord. In continuation to that topic, let me synchronize the previous points related to the spinal cord, which I have discussed in the last class. See, spinal cord is a longitudinal structure. The TS of spinal cord is having different parts like posterior median sulcus, anterior median fissure, and it is having outer gray matter and inner, outer white matter and inner gray matter, and it is having a central canal that is filled with the cerebrospinal fluid. The outer white matter is having myelinated axons, the gray matter is having non-myelinated axons and cell bodies with the nissl granules. So, this is about spinal cord. So, after this spinal cord topic, the next topic I am going to discuss is reflex arc and reflex action. So, let me discuss that. Reflex arc and reflex action. What is reflex action? I will discuss about arc later. What is reflex action? Reflex action means a sudden involuntary automatic actions performed by the organisms. Automatic means without conscious effort. So, the sudden involuntary automatic actions that are performed by the organisms are known as reflex actions. Most of the activities of nervous system are occurring through reflex actions only. And there are different types of reflex actions. See, some of the reflex actions are controlled by our brain, some of the reflex actions are controlled by our spinal cord. So, depending on that, we can divide the reflex actions into two types based on the part that is controlling them. One is cranial reflexes and second one is spinal reflexes. So, cranial reflex means the reflexes that are controlled by brain stem. The spinal reflexes means that are controlled by spinal cord. So, cranial reflexes and spinal reflexes. Next, so after this cranial and spinal reflex types, I want to explain what is a reflex arc exactly. Then I will go get into the other details. Reflex arc is important for NEET. So, I want to explain what is reflex arc. Reflex arc is nothing but it is a circuit which is made up of several parts. So, I want to explain one by one. As you already know the structure of a spinal cord, listen. So, this is the structure of spinal cord, you already know this, and this one is gray matter. So, this is white matter, and you know this is dorsal horn and this one is ventral horn. Dorsal horn and these are ventral horns. Okay, what is a reflex arc? In reflex arc, from the receptors of our body, the afferent nerves will carry the information to the spinal cord through dorsal root. The nerve which is carrying the information towards the CNS or towards the spinal cord is known as afferent pathway. Next, the information that is taken by the spinal cord, for example, into its gray matter, is received by a neuron here. This neuron is known as interneuron. And after processing the signal that is taken by the afferent, this interneuron will send the information to the effectors of the same area from which it has collected the information through efferent nerves. Afferent is also called sensory nerve. Efferent is also known as motor nerve. See, receptors, afferent nerve, this is called interneuron. After interneuron, efferent nerve to effectors. So these parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 together called reflex arc. So what is the sequence of reflex arc? From the site where the impulse originated to the site where the response is going to start. So that sequence is, I can write like this, first is receptor, then afferent pathway, afferent to, if interneuron is present, interneuron, then to efferent pathway, finally to effectors. So this is reflex arc, the sequence of parts. Whatever the stimulus that is passing through this and the response that is generated according to that stimulus, this total activity is called reflex action. So this is about reflex arc. To explain the reflex arc in detailed way, I want to take one example. The example which is there in NCERT to explain the reflex action is knee jerk reflex. Let me explain this, which is also called muscle stretch reflex. One more name to the knee jerk reflex is muscle stretch reflex. In muscle stretch reflex or knee jerk reflex, the receptors which are present at our knee. See, when somebody tap our knee with that knee hammer, that signal is taken by the receptor. You know, the receptor is also called a muscle spindle. Remember this word, it is there in NCERT. The impulse is taken by the receptors, that means muscle spindle. Then muscle spindle carry that information through the afferent neuron, that means through which horn? Dorsal horn, to the interneuron. Interneuron can process, but sometimes knee-jerk reflex can also occur without interneuron even. See, if it is a sensory neuron, it may be the motor efferent pathway. See, sometimes the signal may pass through the afferent interneuron and goes to the efferent. Sometimes the impulse can travel through the afferent and directly given to efferent. If interneuron is not there, only afferent and efferent neurons mediate the reflex actions, means that is known as a monosynaptic reflex. So based on that, there are different types. Polysynaptic reflex is also there. I'll explain that later, but before going for that, let me give you the clear idea regarding the knee-jerk reflex. Knee-jerk reflex is the best example for spinal reflex. Point number one. Knee-jerk reflex is the best example for monosynaptic reflex. Spinal reflex, monosynaptic reflex. So monosynaptic means with only one afferent and one efferent without any interneuron. Of course, it is also having the interneuron, but as it is not having interneuron at some particular sites, we can call it as the example for monosynaptic. And the spinal cord gray matter, as it is processing this impulse and signal, it is known as a spinal reflex. So knee jerk is the example for spinal reflex. But withdrawal reflex, that means when we touch any hot object, we will immediately withdraw our hand. That is the example for cranial reflex. Withdrawal reflex is cranial reflex, and this knee jerk reflex is the example for spinal reflex. And this is the reflex arc and reflex action related to the muscle stretch. When knee is tapped with the knee hammer, the impulse is taken by the muscle spindle. passes through the afferent and given to the efferent, that means through the ventral horn, it will come to the effectors. So, what are effectors here? Effector is nothing but muscle. Muscle is nothing but motor end plate. So, in response to this signal, the muscle will contract. Muscle will contract and immediately will jerk our knee at that area. Will jerk immediately. So, to this stretching of the muscle spindle, muscle is showing the contraction and jerk. So, this particular activity is known as knee jerk reflex. Okay. So, after this knee jerk reflex, one more point I want to tell you. For a reflex arc to form, no need to be interneuron always. Even one afferent and one efferent is also can able to form the reflex arc. So, minimum of or minimum requirements to form a particular reflex arc is one afferent and one efferent is enough. No need for the interneuron always. Without interneuron also, a reflex arc can be formed. So, minimum requirement is one afferent and one efferent. So, next, so after this knee jerk reflex concept, I want to discuss the classification of reflex actions. One more classification. Already I have discussed about the cranial reflexes and spinal reflexes. Cranial reflex example is withdrawal reflex, sudden hot object touching, sudden cold object touching, immediately we will withdraw our hand. So, that is cranial and tapping by the knee hammer, and to that particular signal, when we jerk our knee by the contraction of muscles of thigh and shank, that is known as a knee jerk reflex. So, the next topic is type of reflex arcs, monosynaptic reflex arc, polysynaptic reflex arc. Let me tell you what is monosynaptic and what is polysynaptic. Monosynaptic reflex, polysynaptic reflex. So, what is monosynaptic and what is polysynaptic? Monosynaptic means one afferent and one efferent without any interneuron. So, if reflex arc is having one afferent and one efferent without any interneuron, that is monosynaptic. Polysynaptic means one afferent having many branches, and interneuron plus efferent neuron. So, afferent, efferent, in between interneuron. You know, interneuron is also called association neuron. So, it is having many synapses. When many synapses are there, that is known as polysynaptic reflex. The example for the monosynaptic reflex is knee jerk. Example for the polysynaptic reflexes, withdrawal reflex is the example for polysynaptic. Withdrawal is the example for polysynaptic. Knee jerk is the example for monosynaptic reflex. Next, one more classification is there for reflexes. Conditioned reflexes, unconditioned reflexes. This is very simple. Conditioned and unconditioned. Unconditioned reflexes means the reflexes which do not require any training. So, withdrawal is unconditioned. Nobody needs any training to withdraw their hand when they touch the hot object. But some other reflexes which will perform after a particular training, unknowingly will perform some actions. That is said to be conditioned reflexes. The best example for the conditioned reflexes from your 10th class, you can recall the Pavlov experiment on dogs. So, that is the example for conditioned reflex. And withdrawal is the example for unconditioned reflexes. So, this is about the reflex arc and reflex actions and classification of reflexes. Cranial reflex, sacral reflex, spinal reflex, monosynaptic reflex, polysynaptic reflex, conditioned reflex, unconditioned reflex. And what are the parts of one reflex arc? Reflex arc is having receptor, which is muscle spindle, then afferent, then efferent, then effectors. Effectors are nothing but it may be muscle, it may be gland. So with this, I am concluding this reflex arc and reflex action topic. So after this, let me discuss about peripheral nervous system. This is about central nervous system, like brain and spinal cord is completed. Let's talk about peripheral nervous system. On peripheral nervous system, we have questions in previous AIMS and JIPMER. Based on the previous AIMS and JIPMER questions, let me give you a brief conclusion regarding the peripheral nervous system. So the peripheral nervous system, PNS, consists of nerves, and we can divide the nerves into two types: cranial nerves and spinal nerves. Listen, cranial nerves and spinal nerves. Cranial nerves are associated with the brain. Spinal nerves are associated with the spinal cord. And you know, humans are having 12 pairs of cranial nerves. There are different names are there. No need to write all those names. Just I'll give you the names. Like the first one is olfactory nerve. Second is optic nerve. Third is oculomotor nerve. Fourth is pathetic, which is also called tracheal nerve, trochlear. Fifth is trigeminal. Sixth is abducens. Seventh is facial. Eighth is auditory nerve. Next, ninth is glossopharyngeal. 10th is vagus. 11th is accessory nerve. 12th is hypoglossal nerve. There are 12 pairs of cranial nerves, out of which the important point is which are sensory in nature, which are motor in nature, and which are mixed in nature. So 1, 2, and 8. So 1 is olfactory, 2 is optic, 8th is auditory. These are sensory nerves out of cranial nerves. Next, 3, 4, 6, 11, 12. These are motor nerves among cranial nerves. Next, 5, 7, 9, 10. These are mixed nerves. Mixed nerves. So based on previous AIMS and JIPMER questions, I am giving you this information related to the cranial and spinal nerves. So 1, 2, 8 are sensory nerves. 3, 4, 6, 11, 12 are motor nerves. 5, 7, 9, 10 are mixed nerves. And one more point related to the cranial nerves is, which one is the longest cranial nerve, shortest cranial nerve, smallest cranial nerves? Listen carefully. The longest cranial nerve is vagus. Remember this word. Vagus is 10th cranial nerve, longest. Next one. Largest cranial nerve is trigeminal. Trigeminal is 5. So longest, largest difference is based on length, this one, based on the number of nerve fibers, axons present in a cranial nerve, the trigeminal is having highest number of axons, but this is having more lengthy. So based on length, longest. Based on the number of nerve fibers, largest. Next, smallest cranial nerve with less is trochlear. Trochlear is 4th one. And shortest cranial nerve is olfactory cranial nerve. So vagus, trigeminal, trochlear, olfactory. Longest, largest, smallest, shortest. So this information is enough regarding the cranial nerves. Cranial nerves are sensory in nature, they are motor in nature, they are mixed in nature. Sensory nerves are associated with the brain. There are 12 pairs of sensory nerves. Let's talk about spinal nerves. Spinal nerves are related to the spinal cord. Listen carefully. Regarding the spinal cord structure,
this one is dorsal horn. And this is ventral horn. Dorsal horn is a sensory in nature. And ventral is motor. This is dorsal sensory, ventral motor branches together forming spinal nerve. So this is dorsal horn. This one is ventral horn. Remember, dorsal horn of spinal cord is sensory in nature. This is ventral horn. The ventral horn is motor in nature. This is efferent, this one is afferent. These branches together forming a spinal nerve. You know, spinal cord is protected by the vertebral column. Vertebral column is having many vertebrae. Between vertebra to vertebra, there is intervertebral foramen. Spinal nerve exit the vertebral column through that aperture called intervertebral foramen. After exit, it will be divided into different branches. Dorsal branch, ventral branch, lateral branch. So different branches are there, but the point here is spinal nerve is mixed nerve. So it is made up of both afferent and efferent nerves, hence it is known as mixed nerve. In humans, there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves, 31 pairs. We can divide the spinal nerves based on their location, based on the region of spinal cord from which they are arised. Cervical spinal nerves, thoracic spinal nerves, lumbar spinal nerves, sacral spinal nerves, coccygeal spinal nerves. 31 pairs. These are 8 pairs. Cervical, 12 pairs. Thoracic, 5 pairs. Lumbar, 5 pairs. Sacral and 1 pair. Coccygeal. Total 31 pairs, and all are mixed in nature. All are mixed in nature. So this is regarding spinal nerves. This is enough, and this much information is enough, which is enough for NEET and AIMS pattern and JIPMA pattern. So these are the points related to the anatomical classification of PNS, that is cranial nerves and spinal nerves. After this, let me discuss one more classification of PNS. You already know that PNS can be divided into somatic nervous system and autonomic nervous system. This is there in NCERT. I want to discuss about somatic and autonomic. So after somatic and in somatic nervous system, I told you somatic nervous system relay the information to the skeletal muscles, which are voluntary in nature. Autonomic nervous system relay the information to smooth cardiac muscles and glands, which are involuntary in nature. Yeah, in extension to that, I want to give you some more points related to the somatic and autonomic. So PNS, peripheral nervous system, functionally divided into two categories, two functional divisions. One is somatic nervous system, second one is autonomic nervous system. Listen clearly. If it is CNS, this is a skeletal muscle. Somatic motor neurons can carry the information to skeletal muscles. This is somatic motor neuron. And the first point related to the somatic nervous system is consciously perceived signals are carried by the somatic nerves.
What are consciously perceived senses?
You know, touch is somatic sense. Pain is somatic sense. Vision is somatic sense. Hearing is also a somatic sense.
These are all consciously perceived things. These signals are carried by the somatic nerves.
And second one, it is known as a single neuron pathway. Why it is known as a single neuron pathway? Because a single neuron can connect the CNS to the skeletal muscles. And third one, see, the skeletal muscles are not having the direct contact with the neuron. There is a gap.
Gap means definitely a neurotransmitter should be released. The neurotransmitter that is released by the somatic motor neurons is acetylcholine.
So acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter.
And most of the responses to the somatic motor neuron signals by the skeletal muscles are excitatory responses. One neuron pathway, acetylcholine, excitatory responses, and it will carry the signals that are consciously perceived senses like touch, pain, vision, hearing. Next one, let us talk about autonomic. Regarding the autonomic, see this. This is CNS.
Assume it is a smooth muscle or cardiac muscle or maybe gland.
See the neurons here.
This is one neuron ending here. This one is another neuron starting from this and ending here.
So the autonomic nervous system
can carry the information
which is unconsciously perceived. So it is related to the involuntary impulses.
So this is related to voluntary, and this one is related to involuntary. And first point is unconscious signals.
Next, second point is, here it is one neuron pathway. What about this one?
Two neuron pathway. Among these two neurons, the first neuron is related to the preganglionic, second is related to postganglionic, because this is ganglia. When ganglion is connecting the two neurons, one is preganglionic. So this one is pre. And this one is postganglionic motor now. In between preganglionating and postganglionic, there is ganglion. So postganglionic.
As it is having preganglionic and postganglionic, it is known as two neuron pathway. And third one is
the neurotransmitters, both acetylcholine and norepinephrine. Preganglionic release acetylcholine, postganglionic release norepinephrine. And the responses may be inhibitory or excitatory
by the autonomic signals, inhibitory or excitatory. So this is the basic knowledge related to the somatic nervous system and autonomic nervous system, which are the two functional divisions. One neuron, two neuron, excitatory and inhibitory. Next one, the neurotransmitters of autonomic nervous system, acetylcholine and norepinephrine, and these are carrying the involuntary signals that are nothing but unconsciously perceived, and the somatic senses like touch, pain, vision, hearing are under the control of somatic nervous system, and somatic nervous system carry the impulses to skeletal muscles. The motor neurons of somatic nervous system release acetylcholine as neurotransmitter. Okay, so I'd like to conclude the topic with this. In the next class, I'll discuss about the types of autonomic nervous system and then sensory perception. Thank you.